This is the story of Alf Jed Ayli. As I remember him, Alf Jed Ayli, I was a small child holding my father's hand when I respectfully called the old man Mr. Alf Jed. I thought that was his name. He clipped me across the ears and said, "That's with Alf that I Jed, that is." Now, there's one or two expressions in this poem which may need a bit of explaining to the modern generation. Baize. That's a green baize sheet with a yellow or gold mark across the centre. This mark was aligned with the scratch and the money placed on it. Fowl pence too. Now, this was the practice to stew a tough fowl, and if it was placed on the table, still tough, hard and bony, the remark would be made, "Missus, have you stewed the fowl pen as well? I can taste the wire netting." The fighting cock lectern. The lectern at Wensbury Church is a fighting cock. Some apologists have said it is a stylized form of 18th century eagle. Don't believe it. I have it on the authority of my ancestors that the cock was placed there by a parson who so loved cockfighting that he had been heard to say his fighting cock was the best Christian in his congregation. Now, needle spurs. They were long, sharp spurs manufactured in Bloxwich. These were more humane than the standard pattern, as a wound from them was quickly fatal. Evens at the scratch. The cocks were evenly matched in weight and ability. There was nothing to choose between them. Scratch. A straight line to which the cocks were brought alternately at the commencement of each round. It was technically possible for a dead cock to win. If it was not its turn to come to scratch first, and the other cock was too badly injured to get there or was a runner. Oh, that means run away. I'm shaking 80 years, and please, Lord, give me the strength to tell the tale with brevity and not hold forth at length about the days when I was young and heard the old men speak about the days when they were young, when cocks fought every week. Or if the cocks were not in trim, then dogs would fill the bill, and each fight carried on until it ended in a kill. These bad old days have gone, my lads, and maybe it's as well, for it was heaven for the few, but for the many, hell. Yet sometimes in my dreams I hear the fighting cock's shrill crow, and see again the fighting dogs, teeth bared and crouching low. So gather round my chair, my lads, and let me tell the tale about that famous cocking man, old Alf Jed Ayli Ayle. I know you've heard it all before, how Alf Jed got his name, but just in case you might forget, I'll tell it once again. Now Ayli Ayli bred his birds from Wedgbury fighting stock. He claimed they were descended from the parson's lectern cock. You go to Wedgbury Church, my lads, and see that lectern bird. They'll tell you it's an eagle, lads, but don't believe a word. My grandad saw that cockerel carved in 1842, and every tale that old man told, he always swore was true. But let's go back to Alf Jed and his cock, the Cannock Pride. He matched it with old Podgy's cock, at £20 a side. The footpath by the churchyard was the venue for the main, and that is now the reason why we call it Cockpit Lane. But just 2 days before the fight, they found old Ayli dead. So it seemed, for there he lay, slack-jawed and stiff, in bed. They took him to the Uxbridge Arms, and there they laid him out. The club room was the mortuary in times I talk about. And this was disappointing. We'd looked forward to the match. A needle fight with needle spurs, and evens at the scratch. And so a deputation went to see old Ayli's wife. Said Mrs. Ayli, "Ayli's been a cocker all his life. It seems to me a crying shame to disappoint him now. So in the club room of the fight, I know he'll watch somehow." And thus it was agreed by all, the club room for the fight, at closing time. In them days that meant 12 o'clock at night. And sharp at midnight there we were, all gathered for the match. The baize was spread upon the floor, the landlord chalked the scratch. Then someone looked at Ayli and remarked, "We know he's dead, but he can't see what's happening with that sheet above his head. So down we turned the sheet and took the pennies off his eyes. His lids swung open, and I swear he looked up with surprise. Then Ayli's brother had his say. Our Ayli's gone before, for there he is, laid out and dead, upon the clubroom floor. But he shall see his cockerel win, for win it's got to do. Cos if it do, I'll wring its neck and make some foul pence too. So toss for turns and make your bets and let the fight begin. And Ayli, lad, enjoy the fight, no matter where you've been. Them cocks, they squawked and squealed and crowed, but neither would give ground. 'Twas like a choir in bedlam, until someone looked around, and he saw Ayli rising from his deathbed on the floor. He saw no more, and dived head first right through the clubroom door. Old Ayli's brother Aynuk took the window in a leap, and me and all the others landed on him in a heap. The cocks flew out, and then flew on, and kept on flying too, and they were only seen again, perhaps as foul pence too. Old Ayli staggered to his feet, and looked round in a daze, and then he scooped the cash up that was scattered on the bays. But how much cash that night he got, old Ayli never said. He'd laugh sometimes and say it paid to come back from the dead. His widowed wife was up that night, preparing for the feast. We always had in them days when a neighbour was deceased. And when the door was opened and old Ayli staggered through, she'd said to him, I thought so, it was too good to be true. I don't suppose they want you there, and so they've sent you back. And I've spent all my savings on a dress and suits of black. The kids been so excited that they splutter when they speak. They've so looked forward, bless 'em, to the funeral all the week, and swanking in their suits of black. What can I tell 'em now? But Ayli, they'm your children. Do you disappoint 'em now? Old Ayli, they take kindly to his missus or her plea. He told her where to stick the black, in vulgar repartee. His missus eyed him up and down. He looked so pinched and white, she thought, he'll be a lucky man to last throughout the night. Ah, well, she says, the Lord knows best. I'll keep me black and pale. Please, God, we'll have a funeral in the family after all. And if it's me, says Ayli, the next time you'll lay me out, don't put me in your nightgown for them blokes to laugh about. You'll put me in my Sunday shirt, and lay me off the floor, and shove me teeth back on me gums, and bandage up me jaw. Now Ayli lasted through the night, and lingered on and on. He lived to see his missus, and all his comrades gone. Yes, when his wife was coffined, and before they screwed the lid, he said a few words to her, as all good husbands did. Goodbye, my wench, you wanted bad to wear your widow's black. It warn't to be, but be at rest, you've got your nightgown back. And that's the tale of Ayli Ayle, who died twice in his life. He's gone the way we all must go, and sleeps now by his wife. And on the day of judgment they can wake 'em both must go, by perching on the grave a cock, who'll flap his wings and crow.
In Loppington town there now does dwell a cobbler who is known full well. Going out to milk one morning fair, in elk his fallow he spied a bear. Right-a-ra-ra-ready-dee. Then down he threw his milking can, and off he runs to his wife Anne. He says, me dear, I do declare, in elk his fellow I've seed a bear. Right-a-ra-ra-ready-dee. Then off to Freeman's he did run, to fetch the big dog and the gun. Cart ropes and pikels, likewise stakes, to bait the bear at Loppington Wakes. Right-a-ra-ra-ready-dee. The village it did quickly rise, to hear the cobbler's mournful cries. They surely thought he had been bitten, but they were very much mistaken. Right-a-ra-ra-ready-dee. Bold Alexander run with speed. He vowed he'd kill the monstrous jade. Likewise the blacksmith with his shovel and vowed he'd kill the monstrous devil. Right-a-ra-ra, right-a-ra, right-a-ra-ra-ra-dee-dee. So now to conclude and end my song, I think the cobbler must be wrong. For when they came there, by all that's good, there was nothing at all but a chump of wood. Right-a-ra-ra, right-a-ra, right-a-ra-ra-ra-dee-dee.
Down Sewerage Street, where the smell ain't so sweet, Rough Moe flopped down on his flat-bottomed feet, and under his arm was the pride on them all. The bitches could bite a boat hole through a wall. And back of the bull stake by Darliston Green, Ben Bates brought his bitch, the willing old queen. The queen had a mouth like a shark with the yaws, and God help the dog has got stuck in her jaws. At scratch on the sewer, 100 were stood. They'd all backed the fancy and thirsted for blood. They backed with the bookie, each bitch at odds on. He didn't care which lost, for he knew he had won. The lickers licked hard, and they licked very well. They didn't miss a hair on them dogs, you can tell. A tot or two more, and instead of a dog, they'd have licked all the spikes on a spavined hedgehog. Old Reuben was made referee of the match. The pride and the queen was brought up to the scratch. The bell for the start the timekeeper smote, and both of them dogs went for each other's throat. The queen missed the pride, and Ben Bates shed a tear. The pride missed the queen with a snap you could hear. 5 minutes went by with no sign of a bite. It was more like a dance than a fighting dog fight. Rough cussed for a coward, the pride on them all. The pride seemed too drunk to be bothered at all. And as for the queen, Ben Bates hung his head and cried to the crowd to say prayers for the dead. Then into the pit jumped Rough Moe with a roar. He fell on his face and lay flat on the floor. And then he found out why them dogs wouldn't bite. Sewer gas in the pit, they was too drunk to fight. Rough Moe had a lungful, and didn't feel too well. He bit at them dogs, they bit back, you can tell. The queen had a bite that took off half his ear. The pride had a mouthful of ham off his rear. No matter how Rough urged them dogs on to fight, they both was too drugged and too beggared to bite. He kicked at the queen, which collapsed on the floor, and Ben kicked at Rough with his backside was sore. Them dogs at each other could not pint a paw, and Reuben declared that the match was a draw. The bookmaker blarted, he had to pay back, the money he thought was his own in the sack. That fight was the last by Ben Bates and his queen. Broken-hearted they died in the pub by the green. Rough Moe has never been able to sit, the same as afore he got bit in the pit.
Fellows that delight in a little game, come listen unto me, and I will tell you plain. It's of two champions bold, they fought for a sum of gold, and the talk was that young Robinson was sure to win the day. Young tilly-hazoo, brave tilly-hazoo, brave Robinson forever, and young tilly-hazoo. Their stage it had been builded, the champions on the ground. 50 bright new guineas these champions did put down. For 50 bright new guineas these champions they did play. And the talk was that young Robinson was sure to win the day. Young tilly-hazoo, brave tilly-hazoo, brave Robinson forever, and young tilly-hazoo. 'Twas in the 14th round, boys, these champions they did meet, with their bodies sorely wounded, their hearts all full of grief. When suddenly young Tilly gave Robinson a blow, saying, I will be the champion wherever I do go. Young tilly-hazoo, brave tilly-hazoo, brave Robinson forever, and young tilly-hazoo. The battle being over, young Tilly he had won. A lady fell in love with him for the victory he had gained. And if he do recover, A gay wedding shall be seen, but young Tiley he died when the day's number three. Young Tiley, huzzoo, brave Robinson, huzzoo. And the ladies went in mourning for young Tiley, huzzoo.
Years ago, there was no cocaine or laughing gas. As a lad, I lived on the Chase on the edge of the Black Country. It was about 4 miles to the side of nowhere, and to get there, you'd got to walk it. The nearest dentist, and between me and you, he was a better gardener, was at Warsaw. The colliery blacksmith used to oblige for a quarter to time, and if he could only have punched like he pulled, he'd have been world heavyweight champion. There was no messing about with the fush teeth. A piece of thread was lapped round it, and the t'other end tied to the door knob. Somebody had give the kid halfpenny and tell him to run and fetch ha'porth of suck, and somebody else had give the door a good kick too, and the t'other would be out, and the babby howling, hard and still running for the suck shop though. In them days, travelling dentists used to do the folks as day fancy the blacksmith, and couldn't afford to go to Warsaw. Most on them used to crack on they was Red Indians. Why? I don't know. One of them was the great Sequoia, medicine man of the Parigarik tribe or summit. He used to pitch his wigwam anywhere. He had a brass band of four with him, and he charged 18 pence a tooth. Nobody heard him a squealing. The band played Colonel Bogey too loud. After the operation, he always gave his patients a squig of brandy and charged them for it. Then he let them out of his tent through the back road, where there was nobody waiting to see him, and he'd tell him to go straight home and say nothing to nobody in case they caught a cold with the tough warrant. Now, Billy Dalloway was the daddy on them all. He had a travelling theatre, and used to put on them blood and thunder plays like Sweeney Todd, the demon barber, Varney the vampire, or A Feast of Blood, The Werewolf of Paris, or A Goblet of Gore. A different play every night. One of his players was a Red Indian, all the way from Shoreditch, Big Chief Waterpuller. When he wanted murdering them on the stage, he was taking out teeth in the tent at the back on it, and the groans and cussings that went on was the background noises off stage for them there horrors. Them old strolling players, they waste a groan. After 7 nights of murders on the stage and the owls of the toothless at the back on it, the women used to be threatened to death to fetch a bit of supper beer in the dark. And what one of them pie psychologists had said about the kids' nightmares in them days, I don't know. No, nobody else neither, I'm thinking. Big Chief Waterpuller was billed up as having pulled out the teeth for royalty. He dare say, though, that the royalty was a cannibal king who'd been captured alive and put in a cage for Barnum's freak show. Ah, he used to mount the teeth as well and sell them back to his victims as watch chain ornaments. My mate Charlie's got 4 fingers swinging on his chain to this day. Now, I will tell you somewhat. Tommy Treacle had the biggest mouth in Tipton. When he busted out a loffin, it was only his ears as kept the top of his head from coming off. He went to have a tooth out, and Big Chief Waterpuller put him in a chair and says, "Open your mouth." Treacle obliged, and the Big Chief says, "Go, blimey, in bad medicine, close it, I don't believe it." When he got his nerve back, he says, "Open it halfway, that'll be safe enough for me." "Which one do you want out?" Treacle says, "There's a couple up the corner. One on them may a bit of trouble, I can sleep like a babby with it. But the t'other, it's a nice article. It keeps me awake all night. I can't get a wink with it." Waterpuller got his pinches in Treacle's tooth and got his tongue caught as well. And when he pulled, you should have heard Treacle. The werewolf of Paris was having his goblet of gore on the t'other side of the screen, and strong men went white under the pit dirt, and women was a-fainting and a-scriking old sail. My old grandmother bellocked with the wind until we all thought I was a-going to bust. The young kids, and I was one on them, they stopped running for a mile. Well, what a puller did get Treacle's tooth out. Then it was the wrong un, and he had to go back the next night and have the right un out. Varney the vampire was on then, and you can take it from me, David, and the old black country folk talk about it to this day. There's never been a vampire afore or since, on the stage or off it, that made the blood run cold like that one did. Billy Wallatay, Toad Treacle, if he'd only travel with him, he'd take all his teeth out for nothing. Any road up, when he'd finished taking Treacle's tooth out, what a pillar couldn't find his coat chisel and pinchers, until he told Treacle to open his mouth, and he faked round inside. Treacle says, I don't know they was there. I thought it was a bit of somewhat under me tongue. Treacle's missus says to him one day, why don't you clean your teeth, Tummy? What? Says Tummy Treacle. No fear. I ain't forgot the last time I cleaned them. I had a coat for a fortnight after. In the old black country days, few could read or write. Those who had learned managed it in spite of, not because of the gaffer. Most likely he was as illiterate as them, and his stock phrase was, look at me, with a row of houses in the bank, and I never read a book in my life. I've talked in these programmes of the courage, endurance and strength of the black country folk. They had no fear of death. In fact, they made a joke of it. But one thing they did fear. Fear to the point of cowardice. And that was a piece of blue paper with printing on it they couldn't read. A police court or a county court summons. Or anything looking like it. The ultimate threat between two argufiers wasn't I'll gi' you a sog up there, old. But the reply, if you do, old mon, I'll see you get a piece of blue paper. The lawyers of those days were always the villains of the piece, and the old melodramas, beloved in the black country, did nothing to make heroes of them. Two old sayings come to my mind. When each side employs a lawyer, both sides fight two of them. A pair of lawyers been like a pair of scissors. They won't cut each other, but they'll cut anything between them. I'll tell you straight away, many a man who could face death with a laugh would shiver and be tongue-tied before a bowler-hatted solicitor's clerk or a bum bailiff with a piece of blue paper sticking from his breast pocket. I've heard talk of such a man. He was buried with his two pals in the pit for 3 days, and he said a prayer for them all. Lord, if you'll only get we out of this lot, we won't trouble you again for a long while. Now this man, who could joke with his maker at a time like this, was speechless with fright at a county court hearing over some rent arrears and fainted in the witness box. The court usher was going to fetch him a drink of water, but old Judge Kettle, one of the ablest county court judges that ever was, knew the man's history and his black country better than this, and he said in broad black country to him, fetch him a quart of old ale. The collier drunk it. And there and then the old judge says, how do you feel now? It was all the chap could do to say he day feel so thirsty now. And the judge says, you go back home. You've got 2 years back to pay what you owe. And he looked at the lawyer and says, you leave him alone for 2 years. The lawyer said, as usual, if it please your honour. It don't please me, says the judge, but there's nothing I can do about that. Speaking as a policeman, long retired, I can say the drunkenness was the cause of most of the trouble. They hadn't got televisions to keep them at home in those days. It was the practice, 70 years ago, to save time all round for the police to take a drunken man home and then summon him. The gaffer would send a pound to court and the wife would plead guilty for her Aynuk. The fine would be paid and stopped from his wages. Most likely Aynuk would stop it from his missus's housekeeping and then there'd be a row. The magistrates very often would be the gaffers themselves, and they weren't too hard, for a good chainmaker was worth his weight in gold, never mind pig iron, and 7 days in jail didn't do him any good or the gaffer. Some of the magistrates were retired army officers, and the old Black Country sinners knew what to do with them. It was an eye-opener to me, and I'm an ex-guardsman, to see old soldier Ayli spring to attention in the witness box and say, "I thank you, sir, for leave to speak," and when it was granted, say, "Nothing to say, sir, guilty," to a charge of drunkenness. "What regiment were you in?" barked out General Gibraltar. "South Staffordshire Regiment, sir," barked back Ayli. "March out, admonished," says the general, and out Ayli would go with his shoulders back and his left foot forward to the Duke of Wellington across the road. But Ayli met his Waterloo, though General died, and another brass hat took his place. In marches Ayli, his heels iron tipped for the occasion. The clique he managed would have given old Hindenburg some vitus dance. To the old question, he says, "I thank you, sir, for leave to speak." The old brass hat looked up at him and then says, "Granted, stop talking. 1 month. You are a disgrace to your regiment, whatever drunken rabble it was." Ayli collapsed like a lump of duff with no yeast in. Instead of marching out to the Duke of Wellington, he went down the steps to the lockup, like a tumble-down heap of old bricks.
"And a maid was I, and a maid was I, and I lived with my mammy at home. And I ate and I drank in my gay clothing, for money I wanted none. My cap was made of the finest muslin, and plaited so neat all round. A maid was I, and a maid was I, and I lived with my mammy at home. My gown was made of the finest cotton."
I remember when I was a lad, old Martha having to go to county court over a bit of furniture she'd had on the glad and sorry. Never Never, they call it today. I think she'd paid the deposit and then done a couple of moonlight flits until they caught up with her in our street. It was something like one of the old music hall turns when she got into court. Old Judge Kettle was his honour, and when it come to Martha's turn, she knew she had to call him something important, but couldn't bring to mind what it was. So she gave him every title inside and outside de Brett. He was your worship, your lordship, your graceful, and yours respectably. But he knew his Black Country, as I've said before, and he didn't move a muscle. When he could get a word in edgeways, he says, "What does your husband earn?" Martha did have a go then. She couldn't believe her ears. She couldn't swallow that anybody could be as ignorant to ask such a question and expect a straight answer. "What does he earn? Do you tell your missus what you earn? Because if you do, you've been different to what they've been down our way."
"There came a young man to my bedside, and he asked me if I would wed. And since I was quite as willing as him, he stole my maidenhead. And a wife was I, and a wife was I, and trouble and strife came on. And trouble and strife all the days of my life, for money I never have none. My cap was made of the coarsest cloth."
His honour asked the glad and sorry man what he knew, and he put the cat amongst the pigeons all right. He says, "He's employed as a moulder, your honour, and men in this occupation earn £3 a wick." This, of course, was 60 years ago. Martha was sitting down, but she jumped up all the same. She says, "You're what's it, all that dirty little tow-rags gid me. I've never demeaned myself by calling him me husband. To rear him, me and 6 kids, is 30 bob a wick. No wonder we've lived on Cagmag all these here. He ain't as big as Apath of soft soap. I never knowed why I married him. When I get in wum tonight, I'll maunch him." When he came home from work, he went through the door all right, but a minute later he came out through the window and he didn't stop to open it neither. And he didn't go in again until Saturday, and then he held his pay pack in front of him like a shield.
"And a wife was a..."